gods of the theater, smile on us. You who sit up there stern in judgment, smile on us. You who look down on actors, and who doesn't, bless this yearly festival and smile on us. We offer you song and dance.
Hello there, theater people, and welcome back to Thespis in the Green Room. It is Bruce and Melanie here. Hi, Bruce.
Hey, Melanie. How are we doing today?
I'm good. How are you doing?
I am doing well. Thank you for asking.
Well, we have a great conversation today.
Mm-hmm.
We are chatting with actor and director Myra Greene about her upcoming production of Steel Magnolias with the Milltown Players in Pelzer, South Carolina. Now, I know Myra from the theater scene here in the upstate, but I must add, she is a huge supporter of Thespis in the Green Room.
Yes, and sir.
We are so, so very grateful for her contributions to our podcast production. So thank you, thank you, thank you, Myra. Thank you so much.
Yes. Thank you, Myra.
Now, Bruce, you have actually worked with her on shows on several occasions.
I have. And it's been great. It's always been a good time. A couple of productions at Center Stage that we did together. The first one was Rumors, which was a great farce. Myra has a great eye for farce. And, you know, of course, all the door slamming and the in and out and all that kind of thing, that kind of fun stuff. And also the farce Lend Me a Tenor. So both of them were farces and just a tons of fun. And we just had a wonderful time working together on those productions. And then I got to share the stage with her and also be directed by her in a production of Driving Miss Daisy, which also was at Center Stage. And that was just a real highlight for me. She's just a great director for one thing, but superb on stage. And so just wonderful to be on stage together and just kind of share the space. It was really a great experience. And we're going to get to do it again, too, which I'm really excited about this next year. So, super person, a super director, and just a really great person to be with.
Yes, and it was a great conversation with her. I can't wait to share it with our audience. Mm-hmm. But I really hope I get to work with her someday, sometime.
Yeah.
Or just at least spend more time with her because she is a fantastic human being.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, tell us a little bit about her background and career in theater.
Sure, you got it. So Myra Greene has been acting and directing for the past 40 years. She has worked at a multitude of theaters, including the Burt Reynolds Jupiter Theater, Center Stage, Greenwood Community Theater, Abbeville Opera House, Milltown Players, Lawrence County Community Theater, and Presbyterian College. Myra graduated from Lander University and trained at the Burt Reynolds Institute for Theater, training where she worked with Charles Nelson Reilly, Dom DeLuise, Ozzie Davis, Liza Minnelli, and of course, Burt Reynolds. I mean, that's just amazing to me.
Incredible.
You think about all these people and it's like, oh my gosh. And she talks about it in the interview. It's really great. She earned her MA in theater history from the University of South Carolina and is the former executive artistic director of the Greenwood Community Theater, where she served from 1991 to 2005. Now, that's a 10-year for sure. Mm-hmm. And at her alma mater, Lander University, Myra was an adjunct professor for the theater department from 2007 to 2013. She also served as Lander's Director of Alumni Affairs and Annual Giving and retired in 2017. Mm-hmm. Coming up, she'll be directing and starring in the lead role of Daisy in Milltown's production of Driving Miss Daisy in 2022. That's hard to say, 2022 already, you know?
I know.
But Myra is married to husband Fred Wachter and is the proud mother of Graham Schaefer, who is the technical director for the Greenville Theater. So she's got theater all running around her.
Absolutely. Yes. And of course, we all know Graham. We talk about him in the interview too, but he's also been on this podcast before. So
yeah, that's right. Yeah.
We had a lovely interview.
A great conversation.
With him.
Mm-hmm. Talking about the aspects of being a technical director.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, well, it's an incredible, incredible resume. So I think we should just get into the interview.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's go. Hello, Myra. Welcome to the Green Room.
Hello. Thank you for having me.
It is so great to speak with you. Of course, we've got Melanie on the line. Melanie, you there?
I'm here. Ooh, somebody else is there too.
Who's visiting?
That's okay. We love that.
That was my dog. I'm so very sorry.
What's her name or his name?
Her name is Katie, and she thinks if anybody walks down the street, she has to protect me. So,
well, great.
She's been asleep all afternoon, and immediately we start.
That
this
is so funny. Well, Katie, welcome to the green room, Katie.
Yeah, great. Can't wait.
Well, Myra, you have worked in theater all over the upstate as an actor and as a director for a variety of productions, including a few productions that I have had the pleasure of being part of. I know we did Lend Me a Tenor, and we did I'm drawing a blank. Come on, Myra, help
Rumors.
Me out.
Rumors.
Rumors. Yes, that was so much fun. And then, of course, Driving Miss Daisy, which I loved just being a part of because I got to share the stage with you that time, which was so wonderful. And we're going to do it again, which I'm really looking forward to.
Me too.
This isn't what this is about today. So.
Okay. Oh, well, we digress.
But instead, let's talk about your involvement in the upstate theater scene. What are some of your highlights?
Well, honestly, Rumors probably is right up there with the top because that was my first production in the upstate.
Oh, really? You know, I guess I didn't realize that. Okay.
Yeah, I grew up in the upstate. I grew up in Greer, but mm-hmm. I moved away when I was 18 mm-hmm. and got involved in the theater scene in Greenwood and in Abbeville at the Abbeville Opera House and then moved away to Florida. So when I came back from Florida, I went to work at Greenwood Community Theater. And so, as you well know, when you are full-time in a theater, you're so immersed in your theater, you don't really have time to go do theater, anywhere else.
You're lucky if you get out to see anything else half
absolutely,
the time. You
know? Absolutely. So along the way, opportunities just started to fall into place. And mm-hmm. some friends introduced me to Glenda Manwaring and mm-hmm. we had lunch. And then all of a sudden I was directing Rumors. And it's like, wow, you know, this is wonderful up here.
Yeah. So, you just can kind of go somewhere else and do your thing and go home, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. And at the Greenwood Community Theater, while I was there, I had a couple of people that worked part-time. Both of them worked part-time. And then there was me.
Wow. So you wore lots of hats, as we all do quite often, but sometimes you wear more hats than
right.
not.
So when you direct and costume and design the lights and design the set and build the set and make the costumes, when you do all of those things and then you walk into a production and they say, you have a scenic designer, you have a lighting designer. I'm going, oh my goodness,
I hardly know how to behave.
Theater heaven. And I don't have to be at every performance. Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, that's really nice. So you have some probably really memorable memories of productions that you had directed and choreographed and maybe costumed and so on at Greenwood. Yeah. Do you have some of those you could share with us or a special story that you could think of that sticks out? I know there's probably many over the years.
Well, I started in 1991 at the Greenwood Community Theater, and I was actually brought in to revitalize the children's theater. And that evolved into becoming the artistic director / executive director. And we did like 120 different productions while I was there, plus workshops and cabarets and everything you could think of. Mm-hmm. So it's hard to say things, they all sort of meld together.
Yeah, they do.
I loved Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. Mm-hmm. I will say, because I think that was so much fun and mm-hmm. it had so many people. But then we had Wizard of Oz and we had 107 people in the show.
I was going to say that usually has thousands of people in it.
Yeah. And I had a 14-year-old stage manager that was on a walkie-talkie with the other mothers going, okay, it's time for the poppies to enter the building. Because back then we didn't have any way to communicate backstage.
Sure.
This is before cell phones. Every time we tried to use some sort of communication device, we would pick up things like the police cars going by.
Right.
And one time we picked up a baby monitor in a house.
Oh, my goodness.
So it was an experience. Let me just say, it was an experience.
Oh, that's really cool. But I know you've also been a theater educator, Greenwood Christian School.
Yes.
And also in the theater department at Landry University.
Correct.
So I know you've had a lot of experience that way, too. What did you learn necessarily from working with your students?
I think I was amazed at how many young people are not exposed to the arts. Mm. And so immediately when I started teaching, I went into this mode of, I need to instill this love for theater in these people, you know, right. And expose them to it. So it was just a glorious thing. You know, when you could see the light bulb go off, mm-hmm. I would pack kids into vans and cars and everything else and take them all over everywhere to see their first Broadway tour show, mm-hmm. and things like that. And it was just glorious to see these people bloom and their imagination start to bloom. And then for them to realize there are things outside my little bubble mm-hmm. that I can mm-hmm. appreciate.
Yeah.
And then just to be there in the creation process when you're working with them and you're directing them and see them create on their own. It's a wonderful experience. I absolutely loved teaching.
That's excellent. Well, I know I came across you a couple of times at the Peace Center with groups that you would bring
in. Yeah, yeah.
And it was always an exciting evening. I know I could tell even just from running into you how excited you were to bring the students, because you knew that they yes. were going to see a wonderful production and something that they wouldn't really get a chance to see anywhere else.
And when we saw Something's Rotten, we were able to go backstage and do the tour backstage. Mm-hmm. And so that was a whole nother realm that they were introduced to that they wouldn't normally see. And what a wonderful experience. We're so fortunate to have the Peace Center.
Yeah, we really are.
And everything that it offers.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Were those Lander students that you took to that show?
Yes. Yes.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. So they're college age. That's
yes. Yes.
That's a good age for that. Oh, amazing. Yeah.
Probably four or five of them. It was their first show that they had seen, a tour, you know, that they had ever seen. And I took a group one time and I took them to center stage, actually. And we were coming back and I said, well, how'd you like it? And one of them said, that's the first play I have ever seen.
Oh, my goodness.
And you just go, oh, my
word. You take
it
for granted once you've been in it, you know, and once you've been exposed to it, you just take it for granted when people have not had an opportunity, you know.
Right. And they don't know what to expect. And I'll tell you a funny story. You'll probably edit this out. But anyway,
only if it costs.
No. I would never. When I was working at Greenwood Christian, I had this little guy. He was so sweet and so neat. But he talked like this, and he liked to go hunting. And that's all they did was hunt.
Right. You know?
So I organized this trip because Les Mis Arables was at the Peace Center. And so I took like 30 students to see Les Mis. Well, he's sitting beside me, and that was on purpose, but he was beside me. And so we get to the end of Act One, and he looked at me and he said, you mean they're going to sing the whole time? And I said, yes, they sing the entire time. And he goes, oh, okay. I don't know if I'm going to like this. Well, then we went to intermission, whatever. We came back and it was so wonderful because in the second act, I watched him, you know, he was leaning back in his chair with his arms crossed and his ball cap or his camouflage hat pulled down over his head. And then he started to move forward. And by the end of the play, he was sitting on the edge of his seat and he turned around and looked at me and he said, I've never seen anything like that in my life.
Yeah.
And I thought, it's all worthwhile. Everything we do is all worthwhile. Because
what an incredible first production to see. Yes. Les Mis.
Yeah,
you know?
Well, wow. You know, could have been, you know, Snow White, but it wasn't.
That's incredible.
That is a good one, though, to be fair. I mean, with the barricade and all that. I mean, it's
so engaging in so many levels. Yeah.
Right.
So,
that was the first tour. So that was when, you know, they really were doing all the big things with the barricade and all that kind of stuff. So
and
it was
at least
great.
They had guns because he could kind of, you know.
Yeah, he got into that part.
Yeah, you know, there was guns going and people got shot. So, you know.
And he was waiting for a deer to cross over, but it never happened. But anyway, he was a precious person.
That's great.
That's amazing. Well, let's flash back a little to your beginnings, Myra. How did you first get your start in theater? And do you remember your first show?
I remember my first show. I also remember my first audition.
I want to hear about that.
I was a sophomore in high school at Greer High School, and Lake Williams, a name you might know from the Greenville Theater.
Right.
He was our theater director, our teacher.
Right.
And so he cast me in my first show, and I was so excited. And I went home and I told my parents, and they said, "Well, that's nice, but we can't drive you back and forth to rehearsals." So that was the end of that.
Oh, no.
So I got to watch all my friends do theater. Well, then in my junior year, they built Riverside High School that summer between my sophomore and junior. So I went to Riverside High School. And it was so great because I had somebody who could drive me, or I could maybe drive myself. Mm-hmm. So I got to be in my first play, which was the box office hit, The Boy Who Changed the World.
You don't know this one. I don't think I know this one.
I really would be shocked if you did. It was about cave people. You know, it was about the boy-girl scenario, boy meets girl, girl gets, you know, whatever.
Boy anyway, bangs her over the head, drags her to his cave, that kind of thing?
Yeah, exactly. we were in furs, and it was great.
Oh, you're kidding me. Oh, my gosh.
No. We looked like the Flintstones on steroids.
Oh, this is hysterical.
I really want to read this script now.
Oh, my God.
Oh, it's, you know, it's one of those classics that you just can't miss.
Was Lake still the director at that point as well?
No, I'm sorry. Lake was at Greer High. At Riverside,
Greer High,
we didn't have any. Well, we had our English teachers. And and they became, as happens a lot.
Yes, it does.
English teachers become the directors. Mm-hmm. And they mainly just kind of stood back and watched us because it was so ridiculous. And we just sort of did our own thing. But anyway, I was so thrilled to be on stage. I thought, this is where I need to be for the rest of my life.
So you knew right away. Yeah.
Yeah. It didn't work out that way, but you know, but I really wanted it, and the bug bit really hard. And that was exactly what I wanted to do. But I had parents who said, you need to major in something in school that maybe you could get a job. So, which I've thought it's been interesting over the years. I have worked in theater all my life.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And yet I was told to do something to get a job. But anyway, that's what happens with a lot of people, though. There are a lot of talented people that are not necessarily given the opportunities that would have taken them down that path in a full-time capacity. You both know that.
Yep.
I'm not telling you anything.
Indeed. Well, when did you decide that this was the profession for you?
Well, there again, I was doing a lot of odd jobs, a lot of different things. You might be surprised to know that at one point in my life, I was a probation officer. That college degree to get a job was a sociology degree.
Right.
And so I was the juvenile counselor for Abbeville County for the Department of Youth Services. Which meant that if a child or a teenager or whatever up to the age of 17 was arrested, I had to be at the jail within an hour and assess the situation and decide whether they stayed in jail or went home with their parents. Then I took them to court. When they went to court, and if they were put on probation, I was their probation officer. If they were sent away and they came back, I was their parole officer.
Wow. So
that's sort of what I did for a while. But even while doing all of that, you know, that was a job.
Right.
And so, you know, you find ways to feed your passion. Mm-hmm. So I was performing at the Abbeville Opera House at night after a full day of being there doing that. Mm-hmm. And then to make ends meet, I would run across across the street and wait tables at this little bar. People would see me on stage, and then they'd go in to have a little dessert,
a cocktail afterwards,
and a cocktail, and go, "Wait, whoa, wait!"
That quick? So you would perform and then go work right away?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh! Wow. You barely had your stage makeup off.
Yeah, exactly. But you do what you have to do,
yeah,
to stay involved in what you love.
Yeah,
and so that's what I did for a very long time. And then when I came back from Florida, the job, well, I got some guest director jobs around at Lawrence County Community Theater and Presbyterian College and some different places. And then the folks at Greenwood Community Theater said, how about come in for an interview? And I went in and I did a show there called just a little show you might know called A Streetcar Named Desire.
Oh, and, my goodness, yeah.
Played Blanche. So after that, they hired me. And, you know, that was kind of it. I've still had to have a lot of different jobs through the years because theater doesn't pay all that well. You know, a lot of people think we're just rolling in dough, and I don't understand why that it'd be nice to make those salaries that those people that run up and down a basketball court make, but we don't. Yeah. So we have to supplement, and and so I did a lot of supplementing, but I've always stayed with it in some form or fashion.
Now, because you did stay with it, what was kind of your parents' reaction then? Because here, this was something you knew that you wanted at a young age, and they were like, hey, you need to get a real job. But here, this still fulfilled your life and was a part of your life for the rest of your life. It still is. So, and they had to see that. So did you ever kind of get a sense, well, they were like, you know, you're right, this was the thing for you, or maybe I'm just kind of curious, because I know I kind of had the same thing with my parents. Like, I knew in high school that I wanted to go for theater and study theater, and they were like, oh no, you need a real degree to get it. Something real to get it. And so, you know, and I kind of acquiesced a little bit as well. I did some things to kind of feed that. I study voice and different things, but it was me trying to fit it in to also please them, because they were helping with the schooling and, you know, all that kind of thing. So I'm kind of, and now they see at this age, I'm still involved and have been for the last 30, 40 years of my life. So did you ever kind of have that conversation or closure with your parents about it?
I think in their latter years that they just accepted it. You know, it's just going to happen. And they were supportive. They would come to shows, and they especially liked it if I did a show that maybe their church group could come, you know, and stuff like that.
Right.
And they would, when Graham was performing, my son, Graham Schaefer, when he was performing in shows, they were always very supportive. They would come down to Greenwood and they would make sure they were there to see his shows and stuff. And it was interesting, for a little stint there, I was doing television commercials for different things like J.B. White and places like that. And my dad would brag about that. I mean, we would be out somewhere and he'd go, oh, have you seen that commercial that she's in? You know, and all this kind of stuff. And I thought, that's interesting. I don't know. I guess theater and television in his mind are so two different things. And one's accepted and one's not. I don't know. But anyway, they never really understood it. But I think they accepted it.
Interesting.
And, you know, my mother loved to tell people that I taught school. She loved it when I started teaching at Lander. Well, she's a school teacher. You know, that legitimized theater stuff that I was involved in. But anyway. Yeah.
It's interesting. It just really is interesting how some people's perspectives and, you know, what's more important. And anyway.
Well,
maybe it has something to do with, I mean, actors and theater, that they've gotten a bad rap for a long time, for centuries.
I think so, too. Yeah. I think that is part of it.
It was just considered, I'm sure my parents considered it a den of iniquity at all times. You know, so
right.
They didn't want me going down that path. And that's understandable. I mean, to a certain degree. I mean, they were farmers and that's all they knew. And this was a life that was so foreign to them that they really couldn't grasp it. And that's okay. And that's okay. Because didn't change how much I loved them or anything like that. So things worked out the way they were supposed to work out. I have to believe that.
Indeed.
There you go.
I mean, if it hadn't, I would be sitting here talking to you right now.
Absolutely.
That's right.
And your impact around the upstate, and Graham, of course, is a product of you. He is, of course, a theater professional here in Greenville. So, I mean, the impact has been incredible. So we are certainly glad you're here.
Well, Graham didn't know anything but theater. When he was 18 months old, he started going to the theater with me. So that was his life.
Yeah.
I think he was about 5 years old. And he would entertain himself at the theater when I was in rehearsals. And one of his favorite things to do was go upstairs on the third floor and get hats and come back down and walk through the seats in front of me, because all I could see was the hat going across. And then I would get tickled and go, oh my gosh, you know, how am I going to concentrate on the show? But one night I was rehearsing, and I don't remember the show now, but anyway, it was a one set kind of thing. Anyway, farce probably. And he was bouncing around with his little hats, and he stopped beside me and he goes, "That person shouldn't go out that door. That doesn't make any sense." And then he was off, and then he was gone, you know.
And was he right?
Yes. He was right. And I thought, my gosh, why didn't I catch that? The 5-year-old got it. So I stopped rehearsal and reblocked the scene because my 5-year-old figured it out before
that's
I did.
That's so funny.
Your assistant director there.
Yeah. But he
was assistant directing. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's funny.
He was just so good at everything. And I had him run lights for me at one time, and I could just tell he had this innate sense. And then he started working with the tech crew at Lander University, and he was taught so much practical, mm-hmm. because he'd lived in theater his whole life. So this was giving him a practical
experience.
Right.
So now to get some more practical, real instruction.
Yeah.
Sure,
and then he did his internship at Center Stage, and, you know, one thing led to another.
We loved having him too. I mean, it was when he came to Center Stage, I mean, Tom was so thrilled because he could just kind of say, okay, Graham, do this, you know, and he didn't have to hold his hand and he just did it. And it was great. And it was intuitive. And yeah. So I do remember we hated it when it was over.
Well, I know. And I think part of that is because he did grow up in the type community theater that he did, because I had a lighting designer that I hired from Columbia come in one time to do one show for me. And he looked around and he said, "Do you have this? Do you have this? Do you have this? Do you have this?" And I'm going, "No, no, no, no." And he goes, "This is commando theater. How do you get anything done around here?" And I said, "We just use a lot of duct tape. I don't know what to tell you." So Graham grew up in a theater where there were no resources. And so you had to make do with what you had, and you had to come up with a creative solution because there wasn't going to be a monetary solution. And I think that has really worked to his benefit in everything he's done. Plus the fact, and this is mom bragging, he's brilliant. I don't know where he gets it, but he's brilliant.
He is brilliant.
He is. He is. I can be a little bit objective, not much, but a little bit. So.
I mean, he also designed lights for a show I directed at Center Stage, Hands on Hard Body. So I know firsthand, and not just the manual labor that he did at Center Stage as an intern, but as a designer, he really is extremely talented. Really.
I hope he doesn't listen to this, you know, because he's just going to get
head will be
the
so
biggest old
big.
Head.
But he does have, he just has natural ability. Some people can go to school for the rest of their lives, and if they can't feel it, then they can't really be good designers, you know, because they can't internalize it. He just has that ability, but without a wall full of degrees to support it, he has the ability. And I'm very, very proud of him for that.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
Well, let's turn it back to you, though, Myra. We love Graham, but
I just did the Graham show.
The Graham show. But I want to ask you about your experience with the Burt Reynolds Institute in Florida.
Yes.
So tell me, how did you get there? How did you find out about them? And what was it like?
I was working at the Abbeville Opera House at the time as a production manager. And then I was in just about every show at the time. And I found out about the program, and things just kind of fell into place. And I moved there, had a job at an engineering company that was owned by my uncle, and decided to go over and audition. So at first I auditioned for a play, and they said, "Well, that was all fine and good, but you need an equity card." I said, "Oh, well, that's kind of, you know, can't just go get one of those immediately." And so then they were going to have auditions for the internship program. So I went back and I auditioned for that. And I was much older than most of these young kids who were just coming out of college and stuff. But they chose 10 interns every year. apprentices, not interns, apprentices, and five guys and five girls. And I was fortunate enough to be one of that group, one of the 10. Mm. You know, it was a funny audition because I'm not a dancer. I am so uncoordinated that, you know, I worry about walking across the deck outside. But anyway, when it came to the dance audition, I thought, well, you know, I can probably fake it as long as they don't try to make me do ballet or something like that, because I'd never had a dance class in my life. And so I walk in there and all of these dancers were there and their little leg warmers and all this kind of stuff. And I'm like, oh, geez, I'm so out of my element. And then this guy comes in cowboy boots. And what does he do? Okay, let's go to the second position. Let's do this. And I'm going, oh no. So I tried to learn it. Well, I mean, you can't cram 12 years of ballet in an afternoon, right?
No.
So we go for the audition in front of the panel. And Charles Nelson Reilly was one of them. And
he was
on Dukes of Hazzard. I can't think of his name. It just went out of my head. He was a sheriff. Anyway, they were part of this panel. And so I'm in a room with 20 professional dancers to do this stuff. And I tried for the first couple of steps to get it. And then I knew it was just useless. So I turned it into a Fanny Brice routine.
Oh no, good for you.
I made those dancers so mad because I was bumping into them and I would giggle and I would pose for the judges. I thought, what have I got to lose? Right.
Right.
So anyway, they didn't get in. I did.
Oh my gosh. That's hysterical.
But anyway, it was 52 weeks. It was 52 weeks of the most exhausting theater experience anybody could ever have, because you were in rehearsals for the main stage show, you were understudying, you were usually playing a role of your own, or you were on the tech crew. And then we had our own shows as apprentices that we would produce, and Bert jobbed us out all over town to do these shows to raise money for the Bert Reynolds Institute. And then we would have what we call Midnight Academy. And so when people would come that were friends of Bert's or were in the shows that we were performing, when they would come, he would ask them if they would give us classes. And it would have to be after we had finished all of our duties. And so, you know, a theater performance closed between 11 by the time we cleaned up the theater and did everything we were supposed to do, be by 11:30, quarter to 12, we would walk into the performance space at midnight.
Oh, my goodness.
And we would have class for like 5 or 6 hours, and then go home and sleep for a couple of hours, and then be back for rehearsals at 9 o'clock in the morning.
Oh my goodness.
It was phenomenal. I mean, I was so tired that I couldn't appreciate it fully then, but now I do. I mean, now I know what kind of an opportunity this was. I mean, I had drama classes with Dom DeLuise. Now, that may sound, weird. You know, you would think he would be the person teaching us about comedy and shtick and all that kind of stuff. The most phenomenal drama teacher you could ever imagine. He could pull things out of people that they didn't even know could possibly exist. And then Charles Nelson Reilly was our master teacher. We had Beverly Sills came in and did workshops with us, with vocal workshops. Liza Minnelli came down and did an audition workshop with us. Ozzie Davis was there and taught classes. I mean, the list goes on and on. How would you ever have those kind of experiences?
Yeah. You wouldn't. That's incredible.
Plus, we were on stage with some really talented, great people that were stars, and a lot of them were friends of Bert's, and so they would get a contract and come do things because they were friends of his. But we got to meet them and hang out with them. Alice Ghostly, I thought Alice, she played the Mother Superior when we staged Nonsense.
Mm, oh, she would have been hysterical. Gosh.
Oh, my gosh. And I was her... I was her wig girl. That's what she says. I would be coming here and do my wigs. Okay. And then, have you got the girls ready? You know, this kind of stuff. But it's when you're putting on a habit. What are you thinking? she would sit there with a cigarette in her mouth and, you know, in the nun's habit. And it was just hysterical stuff. But it was just an experience that you could never recreate. And it was wonderful. And then at the end of the 52 weeks, you had the ability to buy your equity card, essentially, because you qualified.
Wow.
But the last show that we did was considered our equity show. That was the one that would allow us to be part of equity. And so my equity show was Anything Goes.
Oh, wow.
And I played Hope. And because I cannot dance, they took the taps off my tap shoes and they put me up on the second level of the boat because he said, your upper movement is good. We just don't want to see your feet. And so that's how I got through my equity performance.
That's excellent. Now, has the Burt Reynolds Institute, or is it Institute, did you say?
Yes.
Is it still going?
Yeah, well, the Institute has had some ups and downs, and it's still there. The Burt Reynolds Theater, unfortunately, was even demolished. It was completely torn down a few years ago. It doesn't exist anymore. Mm-hmm. But during the time it was there, it was a great experience. A lot of people came to Jupiter, Florida to see shows. It was a dinner theater situation, and it was just an experience that you cannot really fathom unless you're in the middle of it. I mean, we went to Burt Reynolds' house to rehearse, and he had pool parties for us, and you know, he took us around on his motorized stagecoach. He invited us over one time to his parents' house, which had a popcorn machine and a big screen so that we could watch movies. Of course, they were his movies, but we watched the movies and he popped popcorn for us.
That's hysterical. That's just, it's amazing.
Carol Burnett was my sponsor.
Oh my
gosh. The time that I was there. So I got to meet Carol Burnett, and then you just run into people. Like Buddy Ebsen was backstage one night and I literally ran into him, nearly knocked the poor man down.
And goodness.
I said, oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. And he said, well, hey, little lady, where are you from in the South?
He picked up right away.
And I said, I'm from South Carolina. He said, oh, I love South Carolina. My wife has some problems. And we just had this long conversation and I was so thrilled. And you just never knew who you were going to bump into. And Margaret was backstage a lot.
Goodness gracious.
Jim Nabors came, you know, we just had all of these. And one of the greatest experiences was, well, you worked on crews, you know, when you alternate your crews. And so for this particular crew, I was the closer, which meant that you had to be the last one out of the theater. You put out the ghost light. You walked through the kitchen, which was horrible, and turned off the lights. And then you closed up the doors and you left. Well, I had done everything and I'm starting to walk out the door and I hear the piano. We had a piano on stage for that show, this grand piano, and somebody's playing the grand piano. And I thought, I'm going to just throttle somebody because I want to go home. So I go running out there and I think it's one of my friends and I say his name as I'm coming around the corner. It was Mel Torme sitting at the piano. And he said, I am so sorry. He told me the name of the person who had turned on a light for him. And he said, Bert said it would be okay if I just came over and played the piano for a little bit. Do you mind? And I went, no, sir, I don't mind. Do you mind if I sit here and listen? So I sat on the stage, like Indian style, and with my legs crossed, listening to Mel Torme give a private concert.
Oh my god.
And he said, do you have a favorite? And I knew he meant a favorite of his. And so I said, well, I know it's not Christmas, but you know that little chestnut song.
And he's that you do,
that you do. And he said, oh sure. And he played and he sang the Christmas song for me.
That's great.
I'm sorry.
Wow.
You beat that.
Yeah.
You know, amazing.
And you didn't have a cell phone to record it on.
Absolutely not. We didn't have anything like that, which is probably good. That's some of the things
probably.
We did. But, you know, it's just, you just can't imagine the opportunities we were given during that year and the people we met.
Mm.
So, and Bert, people thought Bert was, you know, if they didn't know him, they thought of him as Smokey in the Band and that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. Bert was an excellent, I mean, just over the top director. He was so good. And I loved it when he would come in to direct shows because you could learn so much from him. Or when he would come in and host one of our, or teach one of our acting classes or something, because he had such a phenomenal way of directing. And that's the style that I try so hard to emulate in everything I do. Him and the way he, his style of directing, and then Charles Nelson Reilly with his penchant for props, which I love. Mm-hmm. So putting those two together has really kind of molded the style that I use to direct.
Hmm. That's neat.
Can you describe any of that a little bit more? What was it that caught your eye about that?
Bert had a wonderful way of, you know, he wasn't one of those directors that would sit out in the auditorium and yell at people. Mm-hmm. He loved to go up on stage and stand alongside actors and watch the scenes and then walk over and talk to him and say, try this, let's do this, let's do that. And I just found that to be such a wonderful experience because some of the directors that I had worked for, you know, most of them were in community theater and they yelled a lot. And I just didn't really like that so much. So I've tried real hard, even though, you know, in children's theater, sometimes you sort of have to because you have to be over them. But I feel that kind of relationship, the director-actor relationship is very important in building a camaraderie, so to speak, with your actors and then working alongside with them to help them find the best that they can be. And then Charles Nelson Reilly, he loved props. And I just took that from him. Any show that he had, you just knew there were going to be like 400 props. Just get ready. It's going to happen. Because he said actors are too stupid to stand around doing nothing. You've got to give them, you got to put something in their hand. You know, they got to have something to do. And so I try real hard to do that. Some actors, it throws them because they can't think and move and play with a prop at the same time. But I think it adds a lot to a show. It adds another dimension to a show to incorporate a lot of props and a lot of.
Yeah. I mean, you can have like no scenery, but if you've got props,
absolutely,
you have that little bit of a visual effect that just sets everything else up.
Yes. And it gives you something to do with your hands that, you know, it always, in fact, when I was directing the other night, when I was working with the cast the other night, I said, it's amazing how actors are just people most of the time, and they know how to use their hands, and they just use them all the time when they talk. And then they walk up on stage and they become these two dead fish that hang down beside their body, you know. And so sometimes you just have to give them props so that they can become more relaxed to a certain extent with their own with their own body. And even just to add interest. If somebody's just standing around on stage doing nothing and they're watching the scene, I mean, you don't want them to pull focus with the prop stuff. But if they walk over and just pick up a piece of candy or pick up something and look at it or whatever, all of a sudden they have another dimension to them. There's a little more interest. So anyway, that's where I come from anyway.
Yeah, I like that. Well, you also did an MA in theater studies at the University of South Carolina. Yes. What prompted you to go there? And was that before or after your experience at the Burt Reynolds Institute?
It was after.
Okay.
I had been at the Greenwood Community Theater about 13 years at that point. And, you know, I had a child and I just had to find a way not to be in a theater 7 days a week, 18 hours a day. It was just getting to the point that I just really needed a change. And so opportunities were starting to open up at Lander University, but to be able to teach at Lander, I had to have an advanced degree. And so, of course, I would have loved to have had an MFA. And I went to USC and talked to the people there with the idea of getting an MFA, but they had certain requirements like you had to live within 30 minutes or 20 minutes or whatever it was of the campus and things like that. Well, I couldn't uproot my child. And plus I still had to work. So I couldn't go that route. So anyway, I ended up with an MA. It was a great experience, but I don't recommend going back to school at 49 years old. it's you know, it's a little harder.
Yeah.
And that exam that you have to take to get in there, it's a booger. I mean, it's so hard. And then when you're older and you're on campus, you have really fun things that happen to you. Like I was standing in the bookstore holding my books, waiting to pay for them. And this little probably 18-year-old, two people back from me goes, I wish my mother would stand in line and buy my books for me. And I thought, she's talking about me. So I just turned around and I said, I wish mine would too, but she just won't come down here and do this for me. So anyway, it was, I turned 50 right before I graduated, and wow. It was hard. I tell you, there was nothing easy about it.
Yeah, no. I mean, that's
a theater degree now, I guess. I don't know. I've been out of it so long, but back then you couldn't do that online.
Right.
I mean, you couldn't do a lot of research online because a lot of the books had not been transcribed into online mm-hmm. platforms. So you spent a lot of time in the library, and you spent a lot of time reading and mm-hmm. then, you know, driving back and forth to Columbia to go to school. So wow. I'm very glad that I did it, and I'm glad that it afforded me the opportunity to teach as an adjunct at Lander and mm-hmm. to get to know the students that I got to know. And some of them still, I mean, they're all over the world, and sometimes I'll get little messages from them, and they'll say, oh, I saw such and such play, oh, because you told us about this play, and it was playing somewhere, and I went to see it. But so I feel like it was a very rewarding experience, and it was worth it in the end.
Mm-hmm. That's great. That's great.
How long was that program?
I was there 2 years.
2 years.
Yeah, because I couldn't go every day. So I had to kind of space it out a little bit. In fact, the first semester, all I could do was take one class. And I went on Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock, and it was a 3-hour class. So I would take that and then drive back to Greenwood that night and get up the next morning and go to work and do my thing. So, and at that particular time, I was still working at the theater, and I was teaching at Greenwood Christian. So,
man,
wow,
that is juggling lots of hats.
Yeah. So It's so nice now to be retired. What a wonderful word. And, you know, you get to go to theater when you want mm-hmm. to. It's just so nice.
Well, that's a great segue into what we're going to talk about next, because the current show you're directing is Steel Magnolias at Milltown Players, which opens July 23rd. Yes. Now, tell us how you got involved at Milltown, and tell us about the production.
Well, I'm not exactly sure how I got involved at Milltown. I was trying to think of that today. I crossed paths with Will Ragland at some point, and I don't even remember how it all kind of evolved. I know that I had seen Will on stage a couple of times and just was so in awe of the talent of this man. I couldn't get over it. And then somewhere along the line, he called and he said, we're doing a show called Smoke on the Mountain at Milltown, and I heard that you had directed it. Would you like to come direct it for us? And I said, let me think about that. Yes. that was my first experience with Milltown. And then it's been, or I don't remember now how many years, but I'm just so thrilled to be back to do this show.
Yeah. And this is such a great show. I mean, I've seen it a couple of times. Of course, the movie, we all think of Dolly Parton and...
yeah, well, just put that out of your head. We don't want to listen to that.
I know.
Our girls are going to be so much better than those women. I'm just telling you.
And it's interesting. I mean, I was looking at your cast list and I don't really know anybody, which thrills me. I mean, I know Nancy because I did a show with Nancy, but it thrills me because I'm looking so forward to seeing some new talent on the stage. You know, it's not necessarily new talent, but new to me to see the talent.
Yeah.
And so I'm looking forward to see what you bring from these ladies.
I've never worked with any of them. So,
okay, wow.
I mean, I walked in blind on all of this.
Uh-huh. So were you involved in the casting, though, correct?
Oh, yeah. But I'm just saying, you know, the people who were coming to auditions and things, I think there was maybe one that auditioned that I knew. Other than that, I didn't know anybody, which is kind of a good thing, you know, because you come in with a fresh set of eyes and you don't know their backgrounds and that sort of thing. But we're just tremendously fortunate to have the group that we have. They're so willing to put themselves out there and to try things and to work with each other. And I've really pushed them to become bonded and to to be a true ensemble, and they are really getting there. They had a party this afternoon. I wasn't there, but I heard about it. So I know they're spending time together, and they're getting to know each other really well. And I think that's a good thing, because I think that will translate on the stage, and we'll see that.
Well, these characters are such true friends. Yes. I mean, they all have their idiosyncrasies, but they have such a true friendship and love hate for one another here and there that, you know, you really want to have that relationship in order to see that on stage.
Yeah. And it's been wonderful to just sit there and hear Southern dialects, even though they're coming from people who aren't Southern. It's just nice to sit there and listen to it. And mine has just come out so much, during this process, but it's a great show. Mm-hmm. It's one of those that most people know. Mm-hmm. You just hope they don't say the lines before your actors say them, when they're sitting in the audience. But I think people are going to be pleased with the characterizations that they see. I think that these women will really embody the people that they've grown to love in this show. Mm-hmm. And they'll find a new way of seeing it. Physically, some of these people are very different from what they might think of or that you might have seen in the past.
Right.
And just their interpretation of things. It's going to be a good show. And I haven't seen the set completed, but I've seen, the pictures, and I know it's going to be phenomenal. And anytime you got a set with running water and people who get their hair washed on stage.
I know. That's so great.
Come on. It's worth the price of the ticket.
It sure is.
Because they literally get their hair wet. We all have all these women running around with wet heads, and they get their hair rolled. We brought in this wonderful lady named Erica, came in as a consultant the other night, and she was teaching them how to roll hair, roll wet hair, roll wig hair, tease hair, all this kind of stuff. And so, if nothing else, when this is all over, they could probably get a job in a salon. If all else fails. But anyway, and Katie is now going to.
Katie!
But anyway, I think it's going to be a great show. And I'm looking forward
to
it.
Katie agrees.
That's excellent.
Now, there's a villain outside, obviously.
Have you directed a production of Steel Magnolias before?
This is the fourth time I've directed it.
Oh, fourth time. Okay.
Yeah. I love this show.
So how does it differ? Because sometimes how the set might be designed will change how you have to direct the show. Having running water. Have you always had running water? Any other productions?
You have to. There have been theaters who have done it and they've not done that, but I feel like you just have to. You've got to figure out a way. And I think the first time I directed it, we had no water source. So it was, people can be so creative. And so they figured out this container with a pump, and the water would flow down and it would get pumped out. And so it'd be enough to wash the hair, and then it would go down into another container, which would be emptied at the end of the night and that kind of stuff.
Wow.
So there's always a way to make things work.
Yeah, sure.
But I think if you don't have the hair washing, then...
What's the point? Yeah. It's in a salon. The set is a salon.
Yeah. I've played Malin before, and I can tell you that having cold water splashed on your head is probably not the most pleasurable thing that will happen.
I was just going to ask you, is the water warm at all?
Are you kidding?
Too much to ask.
What kind of budget do you think they have? No, it's not. It'll be cold. So it'll be a little shock to the system, that's for sure.
Oh, goodness. Yeah. So when do you start rehearsing with the water?
Hopefully this week. We've been in the rehearsal hall up until, Monday, tomorrow. Oh, what is today? Mm-hmm. Today is Sunday. Oh, my word. Yeah, tomorrow we're moving into the theater, onto the stage, and I don't know if we'll have the water tomorrow, but sometime this week, we'll start working with it. And that's something, that's another little layer that gets added in. Those actors have got to know how to do all of this stuff.
Yep.
And that's in addition to their lines and their blocking and everything else. So it's a challenge. This show's a challenge.
That's great. What's it like? I know you said you've directed the show before, and of course, this is not your first time with Milltown, but of course, we've all had a break from theater this last year. And so what's it like? How's it feel to be back in the rehearsal setting? And what's it felt like to kind of get restarted?
Like you've come to a family reunion and you really like your family.
Cool.
You've come home. Yeah. You've just really come home. And it's just like you just pick up and start going again. Yeah. Some things you think, oh my gosh, I've forgotten that we do that, or you've taken it for granted or whatever for so long. But it's just so wonderful to be back and to know that people are buying tickets and that they want to come back and they want to see these shows, and that you got actors who are just craving to be on stage. And so the whole thing, you know, last year was just a wash. Mm-hmm. Anytime say something about, well, last year when we, you have to stop and think, no, last year we did nothing.
Nothing.
So we're really talking about 2019.
Yeah.
But it's great. It's great to be back.
Excellent. Well, Myra, this has been a blast, as usual. I knew it would be, catching up with you and talking about theater, which we both love, and people we love and all that kind of stuff. So this has been great. And we are looking so forward to seeing the production. I don't know which night I'm coming yet, but I'm definitely going to come. I'm really looking forward to it. And of course, I love Milltown too, and what they're doing, and how they've really reached out to the community and made it affordable, you know, for people to come and see some great work.
Isn't
and
that really, something?
Yeah.
I mean,
it's really, and they really put their best foot forward to give you a quality production.
Right. Tickets, so, $10 and $12. Yeah. That's unheard of anymore.
Really is. You can't even go to the movies for that, you know?
So, and especially you can't get any popcorn for that. But
no, my gosh, you spend three times that.
To have live theater accessible to the masses, essentially.
Yeah.
And what a wonderful gift that they're bringing to the community.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Well, very good. Again, thank you for joining us. And
thank you.
And we, again, we'll look forward to seeing it.
Okay.
Thanks, Myra.
Thank you.
All right. We'll see you.
Good
bye-bye.
Night.
Bye-bye. Well, that was fun to catch up with Myra. She's just a joy to talk to. And I am super excited to see Steel Magnolias. Like I said in the conversation, a lot of actors that I haven't seen on stage. And so that's really exciting to me to be able to see some new talent on the stage. So I'm really looking forward to it.
Yes. It's very exciting to have new blood in town. Or I don't know, maybe they're not new to town, but I didn't recognize a bunch of those names either. So it's good. It's great.
Yeah.
We're growing. I love it.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I know some of the folks have been maybe in other productions, but maybe I haven't seen them. But yeah, like you said, some may be new, some may be just in other things, and we haven't seen them very often. And so to see them in this kind of this great ensemble piece will be a lot of fun and really refreshing.
Mm-hmm. Because Steel Magnolias, it is such a fun show. It makes you laugh. It makes you cry. I mean, it's a modern classic. So
it really is.
So here's how you can see it. Milltown Players' production of Steel Magnolias opens at the historic Pelzer Auditorium in Pelzer, South Carolina on Friday, July 23rd, 2021, and runs for 3 weekends through August 8th. Mm-hmm. So that's July 23rd through August 8th in Pelzer. Showtimes are 7:30 p.m. Thursdays through Saturdays, and matinees are at 3 p.m. on Saturdays and Sundays. Tickets are $10 for seniors, students, and military, and $12 for regular admissions. You can book your tickets at www.milltownplayers.org or call 864-947-8000, 8000.
Yes. And it's incredible prices. Again, we talk about that too, that they have out there at Milltown. It's really affordable. Mm-hmm. And it's not too far of a drive, really, if you don't live in that area. It's a pretty easy drive, 20, 25 minutes from Greenville. And, you know, kind of out in the country, and there's some great places to grab a bite out that way as well. So it's really a pleasant evening.
Yeah, I've been out there for a few different shows now, and I usually come from Spartanburg. And
that's a little more of a hike.
It's a little more of a hike, but I tell you, it's a beautiful drive. We usually do the matinees because it's a drive through the country.
Right.
And it's nicer to drive through the country home, not in the dark.
That's right.
But yeah, it takes probably twice as long to get there from Spartanburg, but it is an awesome drive. It's very nice.
Yeah.
So it's worth it, is what I'm saying.
It really is. It really is. Yeah.
Yep. For what you'd pay for tickets somewhere else, you might pay a little bit more in gas, but that's it, mm-hmm. you know? So, mm-hmm. and I think you still come out better on the other side. So yeah, it's great.
It's great. And, you know, I don't know how Will Raglan has managed to pull off what he's pulled off. It's amazing. he's the founder of Milltown Players, and mm-hmm. I'm just, it's super impressive. And
it is.
I guess they must have incredible support to be able to do what they do and offer those ticket prices and all that good stuff. So
yeah,
fantastic.
Yeah, it really is. It really is. Well, Melanie, it was wonderful as usual to catch up with you again and to, of course, to chat with Myra. So until next time.
All righty.
All right. We'll see you.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thespis in the Green Room is a Courageous Crossings production. Music used in this podcast is licensed by ASCAP and BMI.